Hey, good evening, everybody. This is Andrew Bartman, Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. Thank you so much for joining us for USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 72. Last one for the spring. We're going to take a month or two off here with everyone starting to play. We've got two great presenters for you tonight. We're going to dive into some really, really interesting topics and some really relevant stuff for you youth coaches out there. A slow trickle of folks coming in. I know this was our first time sending in the email for the Zoom link a different way due to our new and updated app and website at usabdevelops.com and also the USA Baseball mobile coach app. It looks really, really good. It's a lot easier to use, in my opinion, and I have to use it a lot. So make sure if you have not, if you've been on the website, but you've not downloaded the app, make sure to download that ASAP and share. Tell everyone you know about it. It is free. It has a drill library. It has practice plan generators. You're going to be able to share practice plans within your organization here really, really soon. The team is hard at work on that. But overall, great functionality. A lot more aesthetically pleasing, easy to use. So make sure you download the USA Baseball mobile coach app and tell everyone you know who is a parent or a coach that works with kids and works with their kid, wanting them to get better. So download that app. Make sure you check it out. We have a whole suite of resources at usabdevelops.com. I will also drop that in the chat. Speaking of the chat, go down on your Zoom toolbar where it says chat. Click on that, open it up, toggle that blue button so it says to everyone, which means to our presenters, myself, and the attendees. Click to everyone and tell us who you are, where you're from, what level you coach. We've had some great friendships born out of this. Across countries, actually. We've had over 10,000 attendees from 56 different countries on our virtual clinics, and we thank each and every one of you that show up month in and month out. So I touched on the new develop site. I touched on the app. We've got in-person clinics rolling coming up. I'm going to be hitting the road, going to Seattle, Washington next week at City Baseball. If you're in the Seattle area, come on out Monday night, a free in-person clinic. Philadelphia, if you are in the Philly area, make sure you come out to Citizens Bank Park, the Philly Stadium. We're going to be in one of the suites there, breaking it down on Monday, March 6th. We're going to be in the Cary, North Carolina, home game for us at the USA Baseball National Training Complex on March 12th. I'll be up in Elk Grove Village, Chicago area on March 14th. Shreveport, Louisiana, March 21st at LSU Shreveport. Frisco, Texas at the AA Frisco Rough Riders Stadium on the 22nd. We've got a clinic with one of our NTS coordinators up in Fishkill, New York on March 26th. And whew, that's just the month of March. We've got some April stuff on the website. We have got some May stuff on the website. We're going to be in about 10 big league stadiums this year. We've got some little league partner clinics that are going down. So we've got some new markets we're going to be in. We're going to hit some of our old stops as well. New clinics are added to the site weekly. So if you don't see anything in your area now, sit tight. We don't do as many in the summer due to everyone playing and vacations and all that good stuff in person. But then we run it back in the fall. So regional clinics will be posted probably next week. Those are two-day events. There is a cost component to those, but it's indoors and on field. You get a USA Baseball Regional Clinics Nike Dry Fit. You get dinner and a cocktail hour day one. You get lunch day two. Great events that we have coming up in the fall. That's going to be in Trenton, New Jersey, Schaumburg, which is a Chicago suburb, Phoenix, Arizona, and Chattanooga, Tennessee. So, all right, I've touched on a lot of our offerings and what we have. We got some people texting me and messaging me that didn't get the Zoom link. Again, thanks for bearing with us as we work on this new system, trying to get this rolling. But I'm going to just turn it over right now to Kyle Nelson, Burlington Central High School in my home state of Illinois. I'm going to talk hitting and some body organization stuff. Kyle, thanks for joining us tonight. Kyle, I see you on here as a panelist. Just want to make sure you're with us. I've clicked promote to panelist a couple times there. Did I hear you there? Trying to get Kyle in here to get us started. And if he is not available right away, we'll kick it over to Coach Bo if he's with us.
I'm here.
All right, Coach, we'll sit tight 1 second. I think we had an issue with, if you're not familiar with Zoom webinars, we've got panelists versus attendee, not versus, we got panelists or attendees. I have to input the panelists into a special segment section of Zoom. And sometimes if there's just the slightest typo in there, I have an issue. So let me try one thing real quick. Sorry for the delay. And hopefully we can get this right. And Kyle can jump back on here in about 1 minute. While we're waiting, also something else that we are doing at USA Baseball is our base compliant organization. So if your organization, maybe you're not part of a national body like a Little League or a Pony, maybe it's Parks and Rec, maybe it's your own tribal organization, et cetera, let USA Baseball take care of all your background check needs and your athlete safety needs. So Senate Bill 534, which we are a part of, being a part of the U.S. Olympic Committee, the U.S. Olympic and Paralympic Committee, USOPC, athlete safety is our number one priority, and keeping kids safe and keeping bad actors out of our game of baseball. So we have Lisa and Taylor and Paris, the athlete safety team. They'd be more than happy to talk to you about making your organization base compliant. We can keep everything in one place for you, for all your coaches, all your volunteers, all your background checks, your education, everything all in one place. That can be a base compliant organization. So make sure you check that out. If you want to bring that extra layer of, Kyle told me ice storm in Chicago just lost all power. That is why we didn't have him. I was trying to shoulder the blame for that, but he just lost all his power. So we're going to kick it over to Coach Vo, if that's okay. Can you jump in with us, Coach Loden Lynch?
Yeah, give me a second here. I'll just give me some video, and we'll be ready. I was curious to know how he was going to be, but all right, let me.
Baseball, baby, we're all about making adjustments. All right, if you're not familiar with Coach Vo Lynch from the University of Wisconsin-Whitewater, one of, if not the most decorated Division III baseball programs in the country. They got an outstanding program, great facilities up there in Wisconsin. Coach Vo, thanks for joining us tonight.
Yeah, you're welcome. So let me just get into this thing. I love these. I love them in person better than on the internet, but certainly this is a big, big important thing that we all do. Years ago, I met just a great coach who mentored me, a guy by the name of Charlie Green Sr. He was at Miami-Dade at the time. And I asked him once if he was old school or new school. And he told me, I don't know, but I always try to be in school. So I believe these things are vital. I think they're important. And I think they fit into hopefully one of a couple things. First of all, if you are here, if you're listening, if you're watching, hopefully I can share something that's somewhat new to you. All right. But for those of you guys that know everything, seen everything, been around, if I can't share something that's brand new to you, hopefully I can reinforce those things, those fundamentals, those ideas that you already do. And I think that always helps us to hear that someone else is on the same page with us. The third thing I think we can gain from these types of opportunities is a network. And I can't promise you that I'm the source of baseball. I mean, you got Bart here with USA Baseball, but I am, hopefully you guys view me as a resource. I'm here to help the game as well. And then ultimately, we're also here to have a good time. And if you have any questions along the way, you know, feel free to get those to Bart and I can stop my presentation. We can go from there. And then just another little preface here. I believe many of you are youth coaches, and I want to commend you and thank you for the impact you make on our young men. And every year people are calling me and asking me about how they get to the next level. How do they get to college and then from college to the major leagues? And I just want to remind everyone that only about 7% of all high school baseball players play in college. And I bet you that number is even less when you look at your youth team. So remember that you're making an impact whether they play in college or not. And I want to thank you for that. Finally, I'm older and I've been around, and we all do some things better than others. And so I guess my specialty area would be to take complex ideas and simplify them. And I think ultimately you know, another thing I learned throughout the years is if you keep it simple, you got a chance. So, you know, my specialty is the simplification of complexity, if that makes any sense. So the things I'm going to show you today are very basic in nature. I want you to view them as a buffet. Take what you like, leave the rest, okay? If you can add it somewhere in your program, great. If you can't, I understand as well. And finally, nothing I show you today should replace good old baseball skill development. What I mean, I'm not telling you you shouldn't hit BP. You should be throwing bullpens. You should be hitting fungals. All those things still pertain. But what I do want to challenge you to do is look at how you're developing the skill game and make sure we're using the right, percentages when we look at how we develop skill. On an average baseball field, a youth team practices 2 to 3 times a week for about 2 to 2.5 hours. That's pretty much across the board everywhere I've gone. Certainly when they get to a certain level, they're probably doing it quite a bit more. Okay. But this is my point. Out of that time, there's usually somewhere between 20 and 30 minutes of free time or warm-up time. And you never win a game by warming up. You just don't. All right. And a good friend of mine who hunts a lot, he says, "Coach, I've been hunting a long time. I've never seen a deer stretch in the woods before it ran." So for me, I'm not saying a warm-up's not important, but I like to look at it differently. And finally, again, maybe if you're in a youth scenario, parents are dropping off their athletes, and you might have 8 minutes before practice where everyone's just standing around. These are the things that you could be doing to hopefully move your program forward, okay? Let me see if I can move this. Okay, what baseball skills am I talking about? So reacting and running, throwing and catching. And when I classified, we either throw or catch. Hopefully we catch balls that are on the ground and on the line and in the air. Those are the three things we're doing. And ultimately, we're also hitting and bunting, all right? The thing that's really tough to teach is that X factor, the basic baseball instincts and IQ. And I could tell you, for all you Southern coaches, you do it better than us up north. Being out on the baseball field is important. Okay, the more fly balls you could see off of a live bat, the better you are at the reacting and running piece. So I'm not telling you any of these things should replace, you know, traditional baseball skill development. But what I am saying is maybe we can look at what we do in the off season, what we do as a warm up, what we do at that time prior to our guys getting, activated and ready to go, because we should always be teaching the game. All right. One of the things I'm a big believer of is constraints. And I define constraint drills in this way. It's either a drill or a tool that puts the body in the desired position that leads us or leading to the refinement of movement. Okay. And I think if you look at a lot of the more active national teams that are working at youth, they're always teaching athleticism. And that's what I mean. And we'll get through with the constraints, but it does two things for us. Number one, what a constraint does, it allows us to create feel in our athletes, which is always better than talking to them. I'm telling you, I know people have changed. I know kids have changed, but talk is really cheap. They don't want to listen to us at any level. They'd rather feel it. And the second thing it allows us to do is it allows a program that doesn't have tons of coaches to develop their athletes with a limit of staff. So those are the two things I want to keep coming back to. And I do believe in constraint drills. They've been around for a long time. And let me tell you what I mean by those. Things like a playground ball. Years ago, I saw Gary Ward. He was the coach at the time at Oklahoma State. And he gave his athletes this playground ball to put in between their knees. And I asked him what it was about. And he said, basically it puts their legs in a good position to hit. It also then prevents a long loose stride and a number of other things. So I love that one. The hitting vest. If you don't know Gordy Gillespie, please look him up. I know Bart does, cause he's from Illinois. Maybe was the winningest D2 coach in the nation. He's very close to Augie Garrido's and Mike Martin's win number. So he had something called a hitting vest. I loved it. I thought it was great. Dowels or towels? You guys have seen towel drills. If they're done properly, they have a place for us. Charlie Green Sr. told me about this dowel system, and we still use it today. It's basically a small stick, and you're using it to create arm whip and arm sequencing. The balance board, you'll see this in the video in a second. It's basically a board that our athletes can stand on to create an optimal athletic base. I love that one. There's connection balls. If you've listened to any of the Texas Baseball Ranch, they talk about those. There's the traditional med balls. There's soft hands paddles, which I believe are the best invention ever for young players. Because what I can tell you is still very true today. The more balls we can feel between our foot base with two hands, the better we're going to be. That's just a fact. So teaching our feet to move and then the hands to move and work is very important. The power drive is, let's not even talk about there. And then either a slide board or stride box. These are examples of what I'm talking about. You will see some of them in this presentation today. All right, ready position. A lot has been said about the ready position. I do think it's the precursor of almost every good defensive performance. Young men and women don't do this very well. I know that their attention to detail is always tough, but I do want to talk a little bit about this. If you train athletes at all and you kind of look across the board, great athletes that have to react. I think maybe the best athletes in that world are tennis players. And this summer I was able to coach at a national team Serbia, and their best tennis players is Djokovic. And so I just watched him return serves, and you will see the same athleticism in him that you see in the great baseball players. We want to be in athletic position. When the feet touch down into that optimal reaction position, that athletic base, movement occurs immediately after that. That's the timing mechanism. So we've developed a series of drills that are pretty simple. And from this point on, I'm just going to be moving through these drills so we can stay on task. All right, here we go. So this is a ready position, two balls, and you'll see the guy get into a ready position and move. All right, here's another guy once again. And one more guy. Do one more. All right, so this is what the takeaway should be. I think the easiest way to get a young person to do it, it should be, if they're a right-handed thrower, it's going to be step right, step left, spread. When they spread, there's going to be a small hop. While they're in the air, that's the time they're deciding to move. As soon as their feet get firmly into the ground in an athletic base, they're going to move right away. So the understanding that when the feet are off the ground is when we're actually making the read. And I think if you look at a person who takes it to the extremes would be a guy like Pedroia, okay? But just teaching this, and this is an easy drill, and I think it matters a lot when it looks like, when it goes to reacting to balls. All right, here's the traditional ladder, and I'm blending it with exactly what we showed you. All right, here's another drill. Same, now we're blending the ladder along with, I'm lowering my center of gravity to drop the ball closer to the ground, and I put a cone out in front. And the purpose of the cone is to teach them to get to the right of the ball, okay? And what I mean by that is, if you watch a good fielder, typically if they're a right-handed thrower, what they'll do is they'll try to put their body in a position to put the ball between their glove and the place they're throwing, okay? By getting to the right of the ball, the feet put the glove in the optimal position to field, okay? Because if we're fielding balls on our throwing side over time, those are going to get away from us. So the cone simply allows us to understand that there's a small a route change when we're attacking a ball. And you'll see his footwork happens naturally. He goes around the ball, right foot, left foot, field. Moves around the cone, right foot, left foot, field. And you can see they're getting in that position prior to moving. Now, here's one other thing I'll tell you. I'm a big believer that most of our infielders and outfielders, if they're going to play a routine shortstop type of ball, whether it's in the outfield or actually at short, I believe that they need a wide base in the last two steps to field that ball in an ideal situation would be right, left, field. And then we also teach right, left, throw. And if you're a lefty, it would be the reverse. Okay, and we're trying to just teach that. And I know there's some guys that are fielding glove side foot, foot back. And we do that with our outfielders, but for basic fielding, right, left, that's where we're trying to work, all right? Once again, these are basic things, shouldn't be replacing fungos or anything else. Flexibility, I've been doing this for 30 years and flexibility is worse now than ever. It's because they're not, well, there's a number of factors. You guys know them as good as I do, but these are some very simple, quick ones you can do. We have portable hurdles that we take on the road. And like I said, I'm not talking about a practice of this. I'm talking about 10 to 30 seconds of this. Very, very basic. Once again, I'm hoping that very simple. I'm hoping that you guys understand it. I'm not trying to tell you that this is going to replace hitting or throwing, but it's getting us ready to go. And I think it should be part of our warm-up. Coordination drills. We call this a salsa step. If you're a taller player, you go on taller ladders or hurdles, excuse me. And if you're a shorter player, on shorter. And we're looking at foot patterns, coordination, and flexibility. Here's the last one we do. And once again, this takes you probably 30 seconds to go through it twice. And that's called a raquette. And we're trying to get some hamstring flexibility and hip flexibility. Let's move on. Med balls. Med balls have been taught for a long time. Our key is that the hands are always going to be connected to that back shoulder. Most young players, when the hands move away, either back or away from their body, they seem to have long swings. So we're always trying to maintain that connection between my shoulder and my hands, and the med ball seems to do that very well. The other thing that is important for young players to understand eventually is that if you want to hit with power to right center and you're a right-handed hitter, your drive line has to match that flight of the ball. The hips have to drive in that position. Just like if you're hitting the ball to the pull side, your hips are doing something slightly different. They're very rotational. But if you're going to drive a ball to the right center or opposite gap, how our hips move are very important. So we're going to do about 30 med ball throws to start practice. 10 of them are going to be to the pull side, 10 of them to center field, 10 of them to the right center gap. Very simple. Once again,
good is remember the hands always move in the midsection. They don't get away from our body. Head ball's thrown.
Pretty simple deal. Here I'm showing you the one of the other constraints is our balance beam. And we put our catchers in there just to see if they have hip flexibility and they have range. I would suspect with all the one knee down stances, we may over time actually see a reduction of the traditional stance, but also maybe a reduction in flexibility. I'm not sure, because I know that if you're in a traditional stance, that requires you to be able to have loose Achilles, calves, and hips. So this is a drill we do just to warm up our catchers. It's pretty simple, straightforward. takes about 20 seconds. So they're going to go on there and go range. Now we're going to throw med balls, and they're just going to try to stabilize. Hitting discs. These are small little frisbees we use to activate our hands. The hand eye is very, very important. Vision is very important in the game. Here we are prior to practice in a racquetball court. And the idea is you're going to shoot the frisbee at him and he's going to catch it. In this case, we're catching with our fielding glove hand. Okay. Where do you get these discs? They're on the top of every tennis can you've ever purchased. And if you know anyone in a tennis club or a tennis coach, they buy them by the cases and they come in 3-ball cans. And on the top of each of those cans is one of these discs, free of charge. You know, I know this is a very simple idea, simple drill, but ultimately, if the eyes and the hands don't work in a game of baseball, you're going to be in pretty bad shape, right? So, and think of what we do to try to develop it, probably not much. So we're hoping that they come with some decent acuity, good tracking skills, and then they could put the hand and the eye together. That's what we're hoping anyway. So simple drill, once again, matters. All right, here we've just changed his orientation. Now we're catching with the lead arm only, lead hand only. He's a left-handed hitter, and he's catching it with his lead hand. All right, I'll just give you a little bit of my thoughts, my philosophy on hitting. I think the lead arm, lead hand, which is the bottom hand on the bat, I think that's our contact hand. People who have bad lead arms have a hard time maintaining contact, all right? I know there's been a lot with power and all that, but I can tell you at every level I've watched, contact matters. It really does. And I believe it's the lead hand that brings the bat to contact. I'm not saying the top hand doesn't have a role. I'm just saying if we train the lead hand, I think it's the top. Now, similarly, when it comes to bunting, I think the biggest mistake we make is the top hand doesn't hold the bat properly. We've been telling these young men and women to pinch the top of the bat so they don't hurt their fingers. Well, you can't control a bat by pinching a little bit of it. You have to actually hold on to the bat and then tuck the fingers. So the top hand, when it comes to bunting, I believe to be the more important of the two. So in this drill, they're going to be catching it with that top hand. Finally, I need their body to be in a good athletic position. The guy on the left's in a good athletic position. The guy on the right, not so much. The guy on the right is my most talented player. But as you guys know, sometimes the most talented guys can get away with things that others don't. So quickly, here they go. They're catching the discs. All right, moving on. Tennis ball against the wall drill. Notice, and once again, this is not replacing what you're doing. They show up 5 minutes late before practice. 4 of them are here. You're still waiting for 5. Put them on a wall. It could be a wall outside, inside. 2 need feeling, I think, does a great job for their hands, keeping their hands through the fielding lane. And when you're throwing it, they're changing bounces. So once again, this is not rocket science, but once again, I'm hoping that I can make an impact in how we manage our time. There's a backhand, pretty simple. right? Once again, he's always changing bounce height. How do you change bounce height? You throw it different spots on the wall. You throw it with different velocities. That will change how the ball bounces, all right? And we're going to keep moving quickly here. I love this one. We do this every day with our fielders. I apologize for the graininess of this video. A couple years ago, my computer was stolen. I had a lot of the video on there, but I got a new one and I was able to find some clips. But basketball players do this every day. There's no reason your fielders can't. So these are ball handling drills. They go around their waist, all right? They go figure eight, and then they do scissors. Three exercises in one. And they compete.
Good. All right. Figure eight, ready? Go. Great job. All right, last one, scissors. Ready? Go. Good job. All right,
All right, keep moving on. Here's the traditional pickup. I want you to just take a look at what he's doing here. He's going to move back and forth with little or no head movement. And he's just replacing the feet. And once again, we're going to start moving a little quicker because these are all very basic things that you could do in a short period of time. If we add up everything I've shown you to this day, we're still at like 4 minutes.
Quiet head, please. Quiet head. Stay down there. Stay down there. Work them faster now. Work them faster.
All right. Just when we're short with a pickup, we do an underhand feed. When we widen them out a little bit, we do what we call the option feed. So right now in this drill, he was doing an option feed. So once again, hand underneath the ball is a soft flip, underhand flip. And when the hand moves in this position, it becomes a what I call an option feed. Okay, and we use both of those with our middle infielders. And for our first baseman, we use almost always a underhand feed. All right, here's with a paddle. So now we're just creating some down angle with our fingers. So we're just gonna tap the ball back while maintaining a good fielding position. All right, here we've created a constraint. We've given them paddles and we've put that yellow tee between their legs. Our whole idea is to create a center line for them. And we always want to field just glove side of center. Okay. The second thing we want to do is we want to gain ground as we field and we want to put the feet, the proper footwork into the throw. So you're going to see them get up here and then their right foot's going to go in front of that tee so that they can use their process. The tee also allows us to visually see if their hands are away from their body, which ultimately is a pretty important thing when it comes to fielding. If you ask your young athletes why, they may or may not know, but the answer is because we always want to keep a quiet head. Back in the day, they used to tell us to put our button of the cap all the way down, but that requires head movement. If you watch a good fielder, his head stays quiet. And if his hands are away from his body, he's able to visually track that ball almost all the way into his club, into his glove without moving his head. So that's what we're doing here. A couple other things. One, the foot movement, the foot pattern is standard for our program across the board. You know, small step, stride step to target. We do that a lot. And this is infielders, outfielders. Everyone's doing this drill for us. All right. Two hands fielding.
Go.
And we're doing this quickly. We're just trying to make sure that he's tracking the ball in and flipping it back. Then we're going to go to zone 2 and zone 3. Those two zones in our program are glove side and backhand side. So right now we're going to glove side. And we're trying to keep his head behind contact.
Change the hops, change the ball.
All right, here's one where we're actually starting the feed. So this is glove side, feed. Something that I think is very important is understanding that the last 10% of the arm action, when we throw the last 10% of the arm action, is a lot like darts. And youth players and even unsuccessful baseball players at every level, their arm always wants to move down and away. Once we let go of the ball, the hand's moving towards the target and pronating. So our talking point, our coaching points are, we're throwing darts. At a short distance, we're throwing darts. That's what we're throwing. We're throwing darts. We're trying to create that feel so that the fingers are going right to our target. So in this case, he's doing a really nice job. All right. Once again, moving again, our catching throwing progression. I'll show you what we do with our catchers. We do something similar to our fielders at all levels, but this is a squatted and we're throwing darts to our partner. We're putting one knee, then the second knee, and we're throwing darts. Okay. We're not trying to turn and, really get after it here. We're just trying to teach them how to feed with their hands. So any short distance throwing like this is what we're trying to do. This guy on the right, he's about 6'4.5", 6'5". So he's a really tall catcher, and you can see he struggles with getting his butt down there, but does a great job of throwing. One quick thing. Anytime we're doing throwing drills, we're starting with the ball in the glove and we're putting the glove in different positions because we want to really work on how we get the ball out of the glove and into the hand. And of course, we're using a four-seam grip. Here's a quick, I guess, our philosophy. Any balls to our, if we can't move our feet and get in good position, any ball that takes our glove hand away from us, we're going to move the glove back to the midline of our body, and our throwing arm is always going to stay midline of our body. Any balls thrown to us in our body region, we're going to always reach and catch and dump into our free hand, right? But if it's over here, way over to the left side, we're going to be really active and rake that ball back to the midline. Any ball over in our window here, once again, we're always reaching with two hands, but our throwing side never passes the midline of our body. Small little thing, but I think you guys understand why that's important. All right, here's one knee drills with the catchers. So on the left side, what you see is his right foot is down and his right knee is up. And on the left, his left knee is up, okay? And what we're trying to teach him is we're trying to teach him how to get his body moving in those positions. The one on the right would be a ball that takes him to the right, maybe like a pitch out or even a ball on the outside corner that he has to move to that position. So he's going to load up on the right side. Any other balls, the majority of balls thrown by catchers are going to be small step, stride step type of footwork. So this is how we develop it on a daily basis. And you see how he rocks into that hip. We're also trying to teach him how to load that up. Ball starts in the glove. We work on the exchange and go. And then the other side. Now we're just going at full speed a little bit. We're just trying to speed it up a little bit here. Hold on. And we're going to start speeding it up a little more. All right, you guys get the idea. These are all little morsels. Hopefully that will help you. All right, T's. T's have a role. You know, you're going to have to decide what role they have in your program. Certainly, they're a good teaching tool, okay? Are they everything? Are they going to do everything for you? No. But in this case, here's a couple thoughts. We have two T's, one that holds the ball, and we always place the other T back by their back hip. The reason for that is, no matter what philosophy of hitting you have, is our hands in the barrel always move down to contact, and then they get on plane. That is undisputed, all right? So your hands go down to hit up. Our hands move down to hit up. We swing down to hit up, okay? So it's nothing in the back of our body ever does anything good for us. So yes, we want to get on plane. Yes, we want to hit just below midline of the ball, but that all happens where my hands are in front of the midline of my body. My hands are never going to fall back here. So what we've done is we've put the ball in the front tee, and we've put another tee back by their back hip. And by doing that, it creates a down approach to contact, and then we want to get on plane. Secondly, we're using fungal bats, which are longer with smaller sweet spots, and you know, and then we ask them to hit to all zones. All right, another little quick thing. Two other things we do. We do use string lines. So on the picture on the left, what you see is you see an L screen right in front of the mound, and there's a piece of string that goes from approximately where the pitcher might release the ball all the way through the contact zone and into the catcher's mitt. That string stays there. We put the tee just above that string line, and it creates a visual as to where we want to land the bat and how we want to work on extension. We also are showing you a ball that's hit right up the middle. So what he's going to try to do is he's going to try to have true spin up the box because the ball's set up for a pitch that he hits up the middle. On the right, you're going to see how we set the ball on the tee. And I'll talk about why we do that at the end. All right. So here we go. So one on the right here, what you can see is you can see how the string line's set up. You can also see how I keep putting the ball on. Long story short, we put the horseshoe away from the hitter. So you see, we don't want him to hit the outside seam. Right. And you guys can say it's hitting inside or staying inside or whatever it is. But we know that hitters that get around the ball are going to pull it foul, or it's not going to have true ball flight. So by how we set the ball on the tee creates a visual for them to understand that we're not hitting seams. We're not hitting seams. We're hitting the leather here. OK, and that's the idea. Once again, a small little thing. And last thing I want to show you today is pepper series. When we do pepper series, we're going to hit balls from the chin to the shins, from the chin to shin. It's not a plate discipline thing. It's a contact driven adjustability drill. All right. And they're hitting the ball. All right. We do them with wiffles, but you could do them with regular balls in a cage, or you could even do it outside on a regular field. But the idea is hand-eye coordination. It's a striking drill. It's not a home run drill. It's a striking drill, contact-driven drill. So we're hitting any ball that's as high as my chin or as low as mid-shin. And this is kind of the last little video I can show you. So this is called the face-off. You can think of it in a hockey standpoint. He's going to stay square, and we're teaching two things. We're teaching him to turn, and we're teaching him extension. This body position is going to make him want to pull everything off, so we're working on extension. In this drill, we're doing a no stride. We're just telling him to hit the ball, and he can pick up his heels, but he can't pick up his feet. So it's front heel on the load, back heel on the strike. All right, this is what a traditional slash, we call it a smash. He's going to present the bat out in front. He's going to pull it back into that connection area back by the ear and the shoulder, and then he's going to work on striking. As the bat comes back, it creates the body load that we want. All right. And we can also do these off a tee. We can also do these on short toss, side toss, full BP. These, and this one is a walk up. We also do a walk back drill, but he's going to walk up and he's going to organize his body to be able to strike. And he also will do what's called a walk through here, I think, in a second or two. Maybe we have that in a different drill, I'm not sure. But the walkthrough will be he'll just pick up his back foot off the ground and hold that finish. And the reason we're doing that is because he's always has up tilts. He's always getting beat on the backside. His hips never get through contact. So what we say after contact, I want you to pick your back foot off the ground, hold the finish just for a split second. So Bart, this is what we have, man. This is all we got. I'm gonna give you one more little thing here. I guess here are some other things that you can integrate for our throwing progression. I believe you got to get them moving. Not every piece of throwing progression should be stand still. I mean, you can get them on the run. You can get them jogging. All those things are good. Batting practice. The Hall of Famer Robin Yount told me, hey, when he went from infield to outfield, the most important drill they did was live BP off the bat. For an outfielder, you cannot replicate a live ball. Okay. And then finally, we have team drill series, and we love situational scrimmages where you set the situation up and maybe you're focusing on runner on third, runner on first and third, runner at, you know, bases loaded, whatever you do, but you set up the scrimmage that way. So with no, in conclusion, thanks Bart for having me. And if we do have time, I can take questions. Otherwise, there you go.
Awesome, man. Some really, really easy takeaways right there. You see it right there in video, folks. Bo, great job. I didn't know you were such a wizard with the video camera and the editing there.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's, yeah, I don't know. If it was good, yeah, that grainy one was mine, the one that you could barely see. That was the one I did.
No, it's great stuff. And I am a firm believer in the hurdles as well. I use it for catchers and with pitchers, and really it's so beneficial for everybody. If you're at a college or high school and there's, you know, hurdles that the team has, your track team has, use them. You can make your own sizes out of PVC pipes. You can do all that stuff, man. The hip, I agree with you. Hip flexibility, mobility is the range of motion is severely, severely deteriorated with today's players.
In coordination. Yeah. You know? I mean, they're just not doing the things. They're not jumping rope. They're not running in recess. They're not doing those things anymore. So I think it's on us to build that athlete a little bit more. And once again, man, I'm not saying that any of this should replace good old practice, but if you're standing and you're doing static stretching for a youth player, I don't know, he's not getting better at baseball during that time. So get him moving, get him doing stuff that at least somewhat resembles our game.
I'm with you. Dynamic warm-up. I was doing a clinic down in Bel Air, Texas, suburb of Houston in January. And I said, hey, you know what a really, really good warm-up for these kids is? They're like, what, am I playing tag? or doing something like something dynamic, something in motion. I said, 8-year-olds don't need to stretch when they roll out of bed in the morning, right? They hit the floor running, ready to go. So I'm with you. Give them something dynamic to do to get started. And you know, it's a warm up. It's not a stretch per se. It's a warm up.
The other thing I'd also say with youth players that young, the game of catch really slows practice down. I think you can put hula hoops on a fence, or trash can tops on a fence, bucket of balls, not a lot of talking, let them chuck. I mean, they're not throwing. We used to go out every day and throw. We'd throw rocks at cars, we'd throw snowballs, we'd do that. But I think that's what you got to do is just get them doing things, and hopefully their athleticism will take over.
I agree. Someone else will tell youth players, youth coaches, man, teach them how to play 7, 11, or 21. And you're playing catch with your partner and you catch a ball at your head. It's 3 points. Shoulders to hips is 2 points. Hips to knees is 1 point. First one to 7 or 11 or 21 wins. So, find a ways to make them compete and have fun. Great, great stuff. You talked about throwing progression. What type of balls are you using for the pepper drills, coach, for those wiffles?
Yeah, so you can use all of them. I mean, you can use any balls you want. We could – the body positions can be applied to any hitting drill. You could hit BP with it, right? You could hit cage work with it. But in this case, we're using like a hard wiffle ball. All right. Okay. An indestructible hard wiffle ball. A couple of years ago, Rawlings made leather covered wiffle balls, which we thought were great because they were restricted flight but I guess they were too expensive for the market, and we don't see them anymore. But in the drill, it's like a wiffle ball, but you could certainly use any mod. You could use tennis balls or anything you wanted to do. Once again, the key is hand-eye coordination and striking. So you could use rocks for that matter.
Right. Bottle caps and a broomstick, right?
Yeah, you can do it all. Awesome.
Well, hey, Coach Bolovich, we really appreciate you spending the time with us tonight. And thank you so much. And good luck as you guys get started your season, if you do get to get started on your season here soon.
Yeah. We appreciate it all. And I'm going to stay in here and listen to Coach Nelson here as soon as I figure out how to stop sharing here. All right.
I can be the man behind the screen and stop that right now.
That's fine. Thanks. Yeah. Get this thing done. All right. Dude. Thank you, my friend.
All right. Kyle Nelson coming in from the Batcave, the Ice Dome in the Chicagoland area, man, Burlington Central High School. Cornerstone Coaching Academy. This is dedication tonight. I sincerely appreciate it, what you're doing here. You're running off a hotspot, off a flashlight. I mean, this is going in the book, right, at the end of your career.
Can you hear me? We'll make sure we've got that down. You got me there?
You're good. You're all good.
Okay. All right. I was pretty panicked when that power went off about 2 minutes before we were supposed to go. So I do want to say thanks so much for having me. Thanks everyone who's out there listening tonight, spending Wednesday night with us, getting better at coaching. Shows dedication. And then Coach Vodnilich, this is going to be a presentation, I think, that matches up well with what you just talked about with constraints and a little less talking and a little more allowing our athletes, to kind of do and explore and learn things on their own. So this is going to be the hitting pyramid. I've got a high school one and a youth one. You see the youth one right there. We'll talk about that a little bit later on in the presentation, but I do need to do some lead up information first. I'll start with a DART study that looked at two different ways of teaching newbies how to throw darts. Group one was taught with internal cues. That's things like where to move your hand, how high to hold the dart. So they're thinking about things that are going on in their bodies and how they're moving their bodies. Group two is taught with external cues, more of a feels approach, you know, where they try to learn the arc of the dart that it needs to go to in order to land at a given place. And what the results were was that the internal group was more consistent with their arm swing, the velocity of the dart came out, because they were able to, you know exactly where their hands had to be. But the surprising thing about the study was that the external group was the one that actually got better at darts. So the one that was learning where their hands needed to be, where exactly how to move their hands, they got better at the arm swing, but they did not get better at darts. So keep that in mind as we go through this presentation. Things I'm going to cover for you, we'll talk about the goal we have for our kids at every at-bat and how we can simplify it for high school youth players. The challenges of a high school youth hitting coach, which Coach talked about quite a bit about at the beginning of his presentation as well. The why behind why I've made this switch in my teaching. We'll talk about two pyramids, the youth in high school. I'll show you some tools and protocols to improve hitters real quick on our batting practice continuum, and then we'll get to the drills that address each of the areas of the pyramid. So the first thing let's talk about is the goals we have for our players during the at-bats. Very, very simple. These three things in order. Number one, hit the ball hard. There's a lot of people out there right now who talk about, you know, hit the ball hard in the air, hit the ball hard in the air, hit the ball hard in the air. And I love that. I do. There's no doubt, you'll see later in the presentation, hitting the ball hard in the air is a great thing. But as you move down the levels, just a hard hit ball anywhere in play has tremendous value. And so our number one goal is to hit the ball hard when we get to the plate. Second, we would love for that ball to be hit on a line drive. Line drives have the highest batting average of balls that are put in play. And so we would love them to hit the ball hard. We'd love them to hit it on a line. And if all else fails, get on base some other way. Walk, hit by pitch, bunt for a hit, put pressure on the defender with your legs and force an error. Any way you can get on base is positive and helps the team. All right, so here's some of the challenges that you and I face as youth and high school hitting coaches. I have 20 to 25 players on my team. 2 to 4 coaches. We hit for about 45 minutes per day. If you're a travel ball coach or a youth coach, you probably get less time than that because you probably have about an hour and a half practice a couple times a week. So you're looking at about 2.5 to 6 minutes per day per player if you spend all your time equally during your hitting session with each of the players. All right, other challenges we have 16 practices until game one. That's going to be approximately 96 minutes with each player, or about 3 half-hour hitting lessons. We're fighting old habits. By the time they get to me at the varsity level at age 16, 17, 18, they have been swinging a certain way since they've been 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 years old. I've got 16 practices until they've got to be able to step in the box and hit an 87-mile-an-hour with a fastball with a slider. I don't have time to have them thinking about where their hands are or where their elbow is or, you know, where their foot, what their back foot's doing. Space is another one. I hope to show you some things that can be easily done in a couple cages. I'll show you our setup right at the very end and some ways that you can maybe create a setup that makes sense for you. All right, so let's get into a little bit of this internal external cue thing. Hopefully you can see both of these pictures of this golfer here. I'm a big golfer. I love golf. And golf and baseball have a lot of similarities in the way they're taught, the swing, things like that. On the left side there, you see that golfer well after the ball has been hit. It's several yards down the fairway. On the right there, you see that golfer at the top of the swing, quite an unconventional top of the swing. I would probably tell this golfer, please make sure that on the left side there, we need to make sure our hips rotate better. We want to get that belly button all the way to the target after contact. And on the right side, I think those hands are way too high. I would make sure to bring that rear elbow back a little bit, tighten that rear elbow. That is Matt Wolf. That year, he was 321 yards driving average, and he was first on the tour with a 68.75 scoring average. Obviously, he's on the LIV tour now, but quite an unconventional swing. If we're starting with a golfer who is 89 years old, we probably wouldn't teach anything that looks like that. There's probably a lot to that that people would pick apart and try to change. So what we have to think about is, what is the goal we want for our hitters? Do we want our hitters to swing like Mike Trout? How many different players can swing like Mike Trout? The answer is one, Mike Trout. That's it. So I was very guilty of this younger in my career, where I would take a hitter and I would say, you know, that doesn't look right here. Look at what Bryce Harper does, and then look at what you do. Well, what we have to realize is that our hitters, they can be very, very talented. Like Mike Trout and Bryce Harper are two completely different hitters. we want them to hit the ball hard and get on base. All right. How many different ways can a player do that? There's a number of different ways that a player can do that. Imagine if they tried to take Hunter Pence and make him swing like Mike Trout. Okay. There's a number of different ways to get this done. The number of different ways that we can get kids to be able to hit the ball hard and have success. So what actually matters, I think it's this picture right here. I think this picture with hitting is what actually matters. And I think it's getting the barrel where it needs to be, when it needs to be there, with authority. Pretty simple, right? That's everything that we do in our hitting program. It revolves around those three things. Where does it need to be? When does it need to be there? And getting it there with authority. And again, I'll show you some of the drills and things that we set up for that. So putting the barrel on the ball, is it a skill? Is it a technique? I would argue that it's quite a bit of skill, and it's a little bit of technique. There are certainly certain things that hitters have to do to be successful, right? There's some things that if they do them, they're really going to struggle to hit if they don't do certain things. But a lot of it is a skill, learning how to time pitches, learning how to reach different pitches throughout the zone. We're going to kind of explore the difference between those. An example I have on here with skill versus technique, skill would be feeding yourself with a fork. Now, it's probably not something that you think of oftentimes when you do it, but if you've ever taught a young kid to eat, you know that you cannot tell them the technique of doing it and say, okay, now you need to slowly decelerate your hand as the fork approaches the plate. It scoops up the food, accelerate the hand towards the mouth. You can't explain that to them, right? How are we doing it? We're giving them, we're showing them, we're taking their hand, we're modeling it for them, okay? And then there's a lot of failure. Right? There's a lot of failure with that process. When you're starting to teach your kids to eat with a fork, there's food everywhere. There's huge cleanup. And I think that's a little bit what some of our batting practice kind of looks like. If you come through our batting practice, it doesn't look like guys roping balls all over the place because we're challenging them and we're giving them difficult things to do. So a little bit of a problem that I had with a cue dominant or internal approach. Okay, where I'm trying to tell athletes what to do with their body. All athletes are going to move different, right? So what looks right for one is going to look wrong for another, and what feels right for one is going to look wrong for another. So we don't actually know what is the best way for them to accomplish this goal, right? You can't model it off of any one player. The other question you have to ask is, can they understand the cue that you're giving them? So a lot of us have a good knowledge of baseball, a good knowledge of hitting. And when we're talking with our players, if they're not at that same level as us, then we can probably spend a large portion of that couple minutes per day that we have with them, either them not understanding what we're saying or trying to explain what we're saying to them. So when the coach is the one dominating the conversation, then a lot of times there's some miscommunication there. The other thing is that we just don't have time for thinking in this game. If you're hitting and you're trying to hit, and let's say, you know, you're coaching 10 years old and you've got a kid with a really good fastball on the mound. And if you've got a kid who's thinking about where his hands are moving in the load, then he's not going to have very much success doing the ultimate thing, which is hitting the baseball hard. And then the other thing is, if I'm depending on my cues to give them something to do internally, I'm going to be with them for 5 minutes during any given practice because I have to get around to all my hitters, all my players. So for the next 40 or so minutes, I'm depending on them to be able to keep with that cue while I'm not there with them. And I know at the high school level, that's probably an unrealistic expectation for about 90% of our hitters. I imagine that number goes up as you move down in age group. And then a lot of times development stops when gameplay starts, because if we're internally cueing, when we get into the game, we're going to go right back to what's comfortable for us, because they're trying to compete. They're trying to do the best they can there. Some benefits of external cues: the player becomes the ceiling, right? Like, hit this ball hard. If I tell you what to do with your hands exactly and what to do with your hips, I'm the ceiling. If I let the player explore how to hit the ball hard or how to make solid contact, then their ability now becomes the ceiling. They start to develop a sense of ownership over their development because it's not the coach that's the one who's teaching them. It's them that are learning. And then a lot of times the technique will come for free. So if you see later on, I'm trying to develop a technique pattern, but I don't talk about the movement pattern at all. I just set up the drill and let them work at it. And a lot of times that technique will come for free. It's going to eliminate barriers that we have, those communication barriers. It's going to limit a lot of them. Here's where I'm at right now. I'm at about 80% external cueing or skill work and about 20% internal cueing and technique work. That number might shift based on someone's aspirations, right? Like if they want to go play college baseball at a high level, I might ratchet up that technique work just a little bit because they probably need to have a little deeper understanding of the game and their swing. If they're going to be going to Iowa State next year as an engineering student and not playing baseball, then I might ratchet that technique work down a little bit. They don't need to have as much of an understanding of their swing. They just need to be able to have fun for 3 months during their senior season. All right, so here's our two hitting pyramids. We're going to focus on the one on the right here. I've got the base pyramid. If it's on the pyramid, I believe it's important. Okay, but the base of the pyramid working its way up, that's the order of things that I believe are important at these different levels. And I'll talk a little bit about what they are, how to train them, and then we'll show you some specific drills later on in order to hit each of these levels of the pyramid. So fun and competition. I think a lot of coaches know we lose a lot of players around the ages of 11, 12, 13 from baseball. Some of that is just that they find passion in other sports. Some of that is that the game can be inherently boring, right? Like if you have a practice where you just go out and you just run a scrimmage, a kid can sit in left field for 2.5 hours, get no balls hit to him and get 2 at-bats. He didn't have nearly as much fun as he did in basketball practice where they're running up and down the floor playing 3-on-3 or in soccer practice where they're playing small-sided games. So we want to try to create these little games wherever you can. Think about any drill that you do on a normal basis and think about a way that you can score it. When I used to work with a group of younger kids pitching camp, we would go through our drill work. We'd go through our skill work. And then at the end, we always played 2 games. We played guess the radar number and who can throw the most strikes out of 5 pitches. And they had a blast playing those 2 games. And every single practice, they would be asking, we're going to play these games at the end. We're going to play this game at the end. Now that's not maybe the most important development part for them, but it's the part that's going to make them come back to the next practice. It's the part that's going to make them want to play next year as well. This generation, a lot of people think that this generation is bad. It's lazy. It's this, it's that, it's the other thing. I don't believe any of that is truly the case. I think they have an enormous amount of knowledge. I think there are a good number of very hard workers. The one thing that I do believe that they have issue with is failure and then failure in front of others. I think it's a social media thing where you don't see people's failures, right? No one puts 5 swings and misses on Instagram, right? They throw the one of them hitting the ball right back up the middle at 105 miles an hour. And then everyone who views that post thinks that they're supposed to be like that. And so this fun and competition just gets them used to failing and failing in front of others and knowing that it's okay, that everyone's going to do it. And then it also allows you to work on that skill, work on the skill of failure. And it just gets them used to failing because they're going to fail in the game. All right. So moving up, adaptability and timing. There's a good old Vlad Guerrero, probably the king of adaptability over there on the right. We teach our players to be on time with the other pitcher's best fastball. At the younger levels, what does that look like? Right? That looks like making sure that we start on time so that we can get the barrel over the plate when the ball is getting there. And with players, I think a lot of times we talk about when the foot gets down. And I think what we should talk about is when do we start? Because everyone's going to have a little bit of a different timing from foot down to contact. But for them, the start time is going to be the one that we can say, hey, for you, when do you need to start? You need to start sooner on this hit, this guy. You need to start later on this guy. He's throwing a little slower. And then getting the barrel to a variety of different pitches when it needs to be there. Again, we'll see some drill work for this a little bit later on. This is a pretty easy tool that you can purchase. We have a bunch of blast sensors, probably four of them in our program. I think they're like $150 each. I like them. We just use the sensor and an iPad. And then we let our kids see what their bat speed is and try to increase their bat speed and try to increase their bat speed and try to increase their bat speed. The level that they need to be at is going to be individual to you and your players. I know for a high school hitter, like 65 miles an hour is kind of where they need to be in order to be able to hit the ball reasonably hard at high school. Coach Vo, yours is probably closer to 70, 72 miles an hour, somewhere in there. But I think that's a neat tool for them to measure it and then for them to try to learn how to increase their bat speed. Now, I will say this, there's a lot more to hitting than just bat speed. You cannot just be a guy who swings at 75 miles an hour. You need to be able to put the barrel on the ball. You need to be able to be on time, swing good pitches. But a lack of bat speed at some level becomes disqualifying, right? Like if you're an 11U hitter and you don't have very good bat speed, but you put the ball bat on the ball and you hit the ball to the second baseman and he boots it and you get on first base and everyone loves you at 14 years old, that same ground ball to the second baseman is most likely an out. And so the people who move up the ranks are the people who not only can hit, but also have the bat speed to do damage when they hit. Remember, our number one goal is to do damage and to hit the ball hard when we're hitting. We want to test this as close to game conditions as possible. So I would not test this off a tee. I would not test this off front toss. I would test this off something that's close to game condition, just so that you can see where guys are actually at. There will be a huge drop between bat speed on a tee and then anytime they have to make a decision of swing or no swing, and then where in the zone they have to swing, you'll see a huge decrease in bat speed. And we want usable bat speed that they can do in the game. Few things on bat speed, because I'm not going to go through specific drills for this. Light and heavy bats, stealing from the world of golf again, light bats develop speed. Heavy bats develop sequence. I use heavy bats a lot of times to teach kids how to load properly. That's a drill you'll see at the end. An easy way for you to do this, if you have a organization, so if you have like a 11U, 12U, 13U, 14U teams, ask players to donate their bats back. And then like the 13U bats become, you throw one of them up to the 14U, that's their underweight bat. You throw one of them down to the 12U, and that's their overweight bat. You want to stay within, about 10, 15, 20% of bat weight. So I wouldn't go send anything super light. That's not going to see the same benefits. We do med ball work. My coach talked about, we love med ball for sequencing, love med ball to learn how to use the entire body. Weight room and body weight exercises. I know that a lot of you maybe are too young for guys to really go into the weight room, but if you can teach them some basic movements, push-ups, some kind of a carry, a lunge, a hinge, and a squat, and they can learn those when they are ready to go in the weight room, they'll have a good foundation. Puberty is a great thing for bat speed. You can see a lot of times the kid who has not yet hit puberty, and he swings it pretty well. And then 2 years later, you come back, he's thrown in some light bat work, some med ball work. He's starting to move a little bit of weight around and he looks like a completely different kid and his bat speed shoots right through the roof. Let's move up the pyramid. Let's talk movements. We keep hitting mechanics very simple. We keep them extremely simple. We're looking for three big things. We are looking for a proper load. I believe if you are not in a good position to hit, that you cannot hit. For me, that's going to be hands have moved up and back, barrel, knob of the bat down towards the catcher's feet. Hands are going to be somewhere in this zone between the rear elbow and the rear shoulder. We don't want to get way out here. We're not going to have any power. We're going to get way in here. We're going to tie ourselves up. And then the weight is shifted somewhere from like 60-40 back to 50-50. And then they're able to accept force with their front side. So they're not collapsing into their front side as they land. Those are my big things for the load. Proper sequence. We want to be swinging from the ground up. A couple things I'll show you that can work on that later on. And then a proper attack angle. As they're making contact, that ball's coming slightly down. We want them to be coming slightly up. We measure this with a blast sensor. I've got a couple things later on that'll show you how to determine without a blast sensor if attack angle is good. And hopefully they can get a feel of what that attack angle should feel like. I know it's a little tough maybe to put a blast sensor on a 12-year-old and say, all right, you're at 0 degrees. I want you to be at 5 degrees. As they get older, they kind of understand the feel. More up is a bigger number. More flat is a lower number. Down is a negative number. But we want to make sure that they have that feel of what a slightly up swing feels like at contact. A little bit more on attack angle here. I know a lot of people think this is that new what do they call it? The launch angle swing, quote unquote. This has been around for a little while though. I'll give you a second here to see if you can think of who said this. It's if you get the ball in the air with authority, you have the gift to produce the most important hit in baseball, the home run. Sounds like something written in 2021. All right. This is Ted Williams, in his book, The Art of Hitting. And then I changed this. Right here. And this is Nelson's take on it. And it's, if you get the ball in the air with authority, you have the gift to produce the most important hit in high school baseball, the double. We went back and at our stats, high school baseball, the team that walked more and hit more doubles won like 82-83% of games. So a very, very important thing in high school baseball, hitting doubles. And again, how do we do that? We hit hard line drives. Those are our ultimate goals. Moving up the pyramid again, plan. I'm not going to talk about hitting plan. That could be something that would be, you know, unique to you, unique to your team. But I do want to just make sure that you include your plan, that it is present in your batting practice. We do not want our plan to only be used in games, right? I don't want, if my plan is to be patient and look for a good pitch to hit, I want to make sure kids get a chance to work on their batting practice. If my plan is to attack any fastball I see, I want to give my kids a chance to work on that in batting practice. And then with plan is pitch recognition. At any level, I think it's never too young to start building your player's library of what they see. Pitch recognition is ultimately a player seeing a ball thrown towards them and then guessing where it's going to end up based on the clues that they have from previous at-bats that they've had. So I don't think it's ever too early to start building that library in some small ways. See a couple different ways we can do that later on. And then at the very top of the pyramid here is going to be what confidence is and what confidence isn't. Confidence is not a false sense of success from block your simple batting practice. Front flips for 2 hours. The kid looks like an all-star, gets in the game, 1 for 15. It's not inflating someone's ability. Coach Nelson, you can get in the box. You can hit Max Scherzer. I really believe in you. I believe you can do this. Do you believe you can do this? Yes, I do. I can't. All right. What is it? It's solving progressively more complex problems and then having the confidence in yourself that when you see those complex problems in a game, that you have been exposed to them and you're ready for them. Does it guarantee success? No. But that is what true confidence is. It is a comfort with game-like conditions through exposure. Quick word about development here. it is not an overnight thing. A lot of people are looking for an infomercial fix. There is no infomercial fix. My son is dropping his hands way down and not bringing them back up. There is no two-day fix on that. All right, we have to go through a slow process of different constraints that are going to help him get there. And then development happens just outside of the player's comfort zone. So when we started a lot of this work back in 2018, 2019, the big mistake that we made was we did not prepare our players for what batting practice was going to look like that year. And I think we had a lot of players who left practice discouraged, who left practice not, you know, not feeling like they had success. But it's up to you to look at your team and kind of determine, okay, where can I, where does my team need? As I'm going to show you some drills, think about this a little too hard. Is this a little too easy? Is there a way I can make it so that it fits my team's ability level and still gives them what they need? You're the ones who are working with your players on a daily basis. So as you see the drill work here, you can certainly adapt it for what you need. We're going to look through some of these things here. Easiest end, dry work, T work. Hardest end, hitting in a game. We'll talk about some of this. We'll go through each of those levels here with our drills. All right, T drills. Like Coach said, varying levels of do you believe in them, do you not believe in them. I believe they are a very necessary evil for a hitting, you know, when you have 20 to 25 players on a roster and a limited space. So how can we make the most out of them? At the very least, let's move them around. Let's work on all the zones. Let's work on up and in, up and away, middle up, down and in, down and away, just so that your players have a feel for how to get the barrel to the ball. Let's gaze at the pitcher, not at the tee. That's going to promote that's going to promote their posture to be too far down. We want the posture to be normal. So they're going to gaze at the pitcher, visualize the pitch coming in, and then swing at the ball on the tee. And then this is one of those things we can do where we can tell if a kid's got a nice attack angle slightly up. Let's say the dividers, whatever they're hitting into, is 2 to 3 feet away from them. The ball should hit the divider or the screen about 6 to 18 inches above the height of the tee. If it does that, we've got a good idea that their attack angle is pretty good. Okay. So that's a goal you can give them. You can even put something up on your cage there that says, hey, I want you to hit the ball at this line right here. And that'll give them that feel. Now that might change a little bit as it moves up and down, but I think it still gives them a pretty good feel for what that attack angle should be. Here's an inside outside take drill for adaptability on tees. So what I'm doing in this drill right here, set up a tee, one in, one out. Right as the load happens, I'm going to say take. All right, and then on take, they're just going to work on making sure they're in good hitting position outside. All right, so then I'm going to say right as he loads, whether I want him to hit the inside pitch, the outside pitch, or if I want him to take. Now, double T, attack angle. This is a movement one. Again, this is that slight upward attack angle here. Pretty similar to Coach Vo's string drill. We just use two T's. So I've got the first tee slightly down below the second tee, and the goal is simply to hit the back ball off the front ball. And if he does that, then we've got a pretty good angle that we're hitting that ball at, and that means our attack angle is going to be in that slight upward movement right there. All right, front toss. Another good one when you have limited space. But again, it's not really close to game-like, so we've got to do something that we can do to make it a little more game-like, a little more challenging. All right, so we're going to try to make the timing realistic. Don't overpower them with velocity. Don't throw 16-inch softballs or high arcers to them. Make sure it's something where the timing is going to be somewhat realistic to games. Don't be afraid to miss your spots. I believe that takes in batting practice are just as valuable as swings. So when I sometimes purposely throw a bad pitch, as you'll see in some of these drills here, that's a good thing that they are taking those pitches. And then here's another attack angle thing for you. Where do the hardest hit balls go? If they go into the ground, their attack angle's down. If they go on a line drive slightly up, their attack angle slightly up. If they go into the top of the cage, their attack angle is straight up. This is a four-seam, two-seam recognition. So this is a good drill to just get players used to starting to see spin on the ball. All right. So what I'm doing is I'm calling out four seam or two seam before I flip it. If it's a two, if I call, so here I call four seam, it's four seam, he swings. All right, here I call two seam, it's two seam, he swings. I called four seam there. I flipped two seam, he took it. Again, just to get them recognizing spin on the ball. With younger levels, you practice showing what those look like. What's a two seam look like? What's a four seam look like? They're going to fail at this quite a bit. But I think it's a really good drill just to get them start to think about seeing spin. Here's a pull side elevate one. This is a really good one for players who spin on balls and have a tendency to hit balls really hard, but into the ground. We want to get them a little bit more onto a line, and we want to try to take advantage of that middle in pitch. So what he's trying to do here is basically hit balls into the pull side gap. Kids have a lot of fun with that one. Because again, as I would say, it's more challenging than they think, because a lot of times they'll spin and just hammer it at the third baseman. They really have to get that slight word up attack angle there. Our regular batting practice, a lot of people have heard the term 40-40-40. That's a 40-year-old throwing 40 miles an hour from 40 feet. When you're throwing traditional batting practice, it's okay to be bad sometimes. Think about what their swing rate is in a game, maybe 40-50%. It should not be 100% in your batting practice. This drill is a hot spot drill, really similar to the two-seam, four-seam drill, except now I'm calling a location. Okay, you can do this with front toss if you need to in order to get a little more accuracy. This is just something to get them thinking about the zones, thinking about inside, outside, and where they're hunting the pitch. So if I call inside here, throw outside, he takes. No take BP. Coach showed this one earlier. He called it by a different name, though. He's swinging at everything I throw. Sometimes hitters have to get creative in order to put the barrel on the ball and make something good happen, especially with two strikes. They'll like this one. Throw it outside of the zone on purpose, and we just let them try to create different solutions and just get the ball in play. All right, so if we've got a machine, some of us have machines. I personally love these mini hack attacks. I've had nothing but trouble with the big ones. The mini ones, I love them. They're awesome. A couple of different things you can do just to change things up and adapt with machines. Round one, inside fastball. Round two, outside fastball. Two strike drill. This is one of my favorite things to do with machines. They are just inaccurate enough to make this a really good drill. You try to line it up so that a lot of pitches go over the outside corner, but some are going to miss on the plate and some are going to miss off the plate. And you just say two strikes, drop it, and they're either swinging or taking. Some of them they'll take because they're outside. Some of them they'll swing at because they're on the corner. Same thing goes with a high fastball. Set it up at the belt, and then just let it roll. Sometimes it'll fire it a little bit high out of the zone, take. Sometimes it'll be down in the zone, swing. Fastball curveball combo. This is adaptability. So round one, high fastball. Round two, same tunnel. So high fastball to curveball. And if you want some of these settings, I have the full hack attack settings and then also the mini ones. One of the issues I've found with mini ones is that they have, with the hack attacks, is that the spin on the things they give you are a lot. So we kind of went through and actually found the spin on them, so they were a little more appropriate. So if you want that, you can go ahead and email me. I'll have my contact information at the end. Love a three plate drill with it. So you set up three plates about a foot to 2 feet apart, and they just move between those three plates. So they move up, they move up, they move back, they move back. It's just a timing drill. And then bring it on. You set up the like five plates. If they barrel it up, they move up. If they barrel it up, they move up. And the closer they get to the machine, obviously, the quicker it gets. Here's a little bit more advanced drills. if you can't throw curveballs, either find a older brother of one of your players that can come in and throw some curveballs, or even just learn how to spin it, even if it doesn't really break very much. Because what we're really working on in these drills is just their vision and just getting them used to seeing different things. So this is a hot pitch drill. It's the exact same thing as hot spot, except now it's on pitch, fastball or curveball. I called fastball, I threw curveball. Curveball, I throw fastball, he takes. I call curveball, I throw curveball, he swings. And again, just something to get, I don't think it's ever too young to start working on some vision drills and seeing the ball differently. This may be a really good drill right here for someone who's about 11, 12, and just starting to see some curveballs in the game. Very hard drill. Three plate drill, I mentioned that earlier. I'll show this right here. So you start in the middle plate. That's like our normal timing. Take two swings middle. Then we're going to move back. I'm trying to throw the ball at the same velocity, probably why this works a little bit better off the machine. But then now he's just got to start later, right? So the cue is just start later. Now he's going to move all the way up to the front here. And this is really coming at him here from that distance. But again, we're just starting sooner. We're just worried about when do we start. And you maybe need to adapt that for your kids if you're going to do it underhand or the plates aren't quite so far apart, however that works for you. This is a fun one right here. You know, for us, this is probably much more towards the 13, 14 U, but we use heavy and light bats for timing as well. So here is at the middle with his normal bat. Then he's going to move to the back and he's going to grab this light bat. So now that just feeds the mistake, right? The mistake is he's going to be super early because it's later timing. Okay. And he's using a lighter bat. And then he's going to grab this heavy power pipe here, and he's going to move up to the front where he's got to be the quickest. You see how late he was there. All right. So again, that's a pretty advanced drill, but think about how you can adapt those three plate drills to do what you need at your levels. Versus live in practice, I think this is a huge thing to do for your athletes. Once you get, for us, it happens right away. Again, we've got 17 practices till we go. But we dedicate one cage a day to live. We take three or four pitchers, four or five hitters, including our catchers. They get to hit every day because they're back there getting their bullpens, getting their catching work in. So we dedicate one cage a day for this live hitting off of pitchers because it's what they're going to do in games. And so it's what they really, truly need to see and be able to do. Here's our setup right here. So we have two full length cages, which we have bought dividers for so that we can make them into smaller cages. So we've got four cage stations. We teach our kids to throw. We only have two coaches. So we put a helmet on them. We teach them how to throw these. Actually pretty good for your pitchers. They get to spin some breaking balls. If you're coaching like, you know, much below 14U, I probably wouldn't have them doing that. But you probably have three or four coaches that you can get back behind here. We set up T stations on the outside. We'll use a med ball throwing station. We'll have a bunting station. And then something that we started doing that I really like is we got all our drills made on signs, and they've got carabiner clips. And then I just go around each day and clip the drills up at the stations that we want them to do. They go to that. They rotate about 2 minutes per hitter per station. And then we've got some live hitting going on in the field as well. So your challenge for today, take this pyramid, think about what's important for you, what's important for your athletes, what's important for your players, and create your own pyramid, and then go through the drills, some of them that you maybe learned here today, some of them that you've seen at other presenters, some of them you've already been doing, and then bucket them in there and say, when I want to work on this, what drill do I have in my back pocket to work on? on pitch selection? What drill do I have in my back pocket to work on? To work on bat speed? What drill do I have in my back pocket to work on attack angle? So some contact info for you there. Kyler Cornerstone, coachingacademy.com, and then Twitter at @coach_K Nelson as well. So if you would like some of those machine settings, I can send those over to you, or if you have any questions about anything that they did here. So that's what I've got today. Thanks so much for having me. I appreciate it, Coach.
Sorry, I had trouble clicking my buttons there, man. I got no excuse. I got no excuses for what I'm going through compared to you. How happy is your wife right now?
I'm trying to unshare my screen here.
How happy is your wife right now that you're just doing this?
Oh, she's downstairs in the basement with our dogs and our daughter and trying to keep them from. I can hear them down there. I hope you guys couldn't hear them there.
Oh man, I tell you what, we're gonna cut Q&A a little bit. Coach left his contact info there for you. We're gonna let him get back to his family. Awesome information right there, and definitely stuff that you can scale for youth players. And I know you've got a ton of great info with Cornerstone Coaching Academy. So you want to just talk briefly a couple minutes about what that is and what that offers?
So I've got a podcast that I run. It's the Cornerstone Coaching Academy podcast. I actually just brought on a co-host with me. I was getting kind of tired of doing solo shows. And so actually the guy you see in the video there is my co-host now. He's a young trainer in our area. And our goal in it basically is just 15 to 20 minutes of something really, really actionable that you can, like, one topic. Like our last one was just the stance, stride, and load phase of the swing and how you can work on that with different age groups. And I don't just cover hitting in there. We cover pitching and defense and practice organization and all that stuff. So
yeah, it's awesome. Really good resources for youth coaches. So, hey, we love our USA Baseball resources, but man, there's so much really good stuff out there that maybe you gotta take a dive into something new, check out Cornerstone and see if there's something that might work for you. So thanks for bringing that to everyone's attention, Coach Nelson. Man, thanks a lot for just getting it done. Baseball guys, I've said it before, we're all about making adjustments. So we appreciate you coming on tonight and sharing so much. That's awesome.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
To my Midwest guys, Coach Kyle Nelson, Coach John Bodenlich, we appreciate you all being with us tonight. And guys, went a little bit longer than usual. We had two presenters instead of our three or four. But the content was just outstanding. So can't thank these guys enough. And I want to direct everyone to usabdevelops.com, as I said before, for some great, great, great content. Revamped website. It looks outstanding. Sarah and Lauren and the team did an excellent job revamping that, rebranding that. And the USA Baseball Mobile Coach app has a new look as well. Easy to use. Tile functions. It's really, really good. So check it out. Share. We ask you. I want to direct you instead to share our resources with as many people as you know that coach baseball or parents who have kids who play baseball. And new hoodies, a lot of new gear at the usabaseballshop.com. Check out usabaseballshop.com for all of your official USA Baseball gear and accessories. So with that being said, this is Andrew Bartman, Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. I hope to see you out on the road at one of our in-person community coaches clinics. As I said before, I'll be in Seattle Monday night. We'll be in Philly Monday, March 6th. We'll be in Cary, North Carolina, home game for us at our National Training Complex, March 12th. Check out coachclinicsplural.org. That is part of usabdevelopsplural.com. That's got a listing of all of our in-person coaches clinics as well as our upcoming virtual clinics. So I'm signing off. This was USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 72. Thank you so much for joining us tonight, and go out and make those kids better. Thanks a lot.